And good morning, and welcome everyone to the 9th meeting of the Citizens' Participation in Public Petitions Committee of 2023. We have apologies this morning from the Deputy Convener of the Committee, David Torrance. And our first agenda item is actually to agree to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are we agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. And that brings us to agenda item 2, which is the consideration of continued petitions. And the first of those this morning is petition number 1864, which is to increase the ability of communities to influence planning decisions for onshore wind farms. And this has been lodged by Aileen Jackson on behalf of Scotland Against Spin. And it urges the calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to increase the ability of communities to influence planning decisions for onshore wind farms by adopting English planning legislation for the determination of onshore wind farm developments, empowering local authorities to ensure local communities are given sufficient professional help to engage in the planning process, and by appointing an independent advocate to ensure that local participants are not bullied and intimidated during public inquiries. And we last considered this petition on the 18th of January, and we agreed then to write to the Scottish Government setting out recommendations based on evidence that we've received over the last 2 years. We're joined this morning by Brian Whittle, MSP, and I'll invite him to comment in just a couple of moments. In response to our submission to the Scottish Government, the new local minister for local government, empowerment and planning has accepted two of our recommendations and committed to exploring the benefits and disadvantages of altering the 50 milliwatt threshold, megawatt even. Bit of a distinction there, sorry. Megawatt even threshold. And the scope for planning authorities to determine more applications for onshore wind farm developments. We've also received a submission from the petitioner, which welcomes this commitment, which is good to hear. In relation to our recommendation on ensuring demonstration of local support is a key material consideration in the decision-making process, the Minister mentions that local opinion and evidence feature strongly in planning assessments and highlights the provisions introduced by the Planning Scotland Act 2019, which are intended to strengthen the voice of communities in the planning process. While the petitioner has welcomed the government's commitment in relation to thresholds, she remains concerned that there is no definition of what ensuring communities have, and I quote, a meaningful say, looks like in practice, drawing parallels with the First Minister's recent comments in relation to highly protected marine areas and engagement with coastal communities. And before I ask colleagues to comment, I wonder if Brian Whittle has got anything he would like to contribute.
I'm very grateful, Convener. Thank you for the opportunity to come and speak in this particular petition. As a South of Scotland MSP, I have many wind farm developments in my region, and I'm very often, I have letters from constituents complaining about onshore wind and this particular element of planning. And I think that the public perception is, and I'm very grateful that Mr Ewing's here because he'll be able to probably be able to clarify this, but the perception from the public is that that there's a presumption that planning will be given, even if it's initially turned down by the local council. It'll go in front of the government and the likelihood is it will get passed. And that is that's the public perception of what's happening. I think that when my dealings with wind farm developers, it's always my recommendation is always that they engage more with the local community. As it currently stands, that's not the feeling that the public are giving to me, in that many times it takes them a while to find out whether or not there's a wind farm development in the offing, and often it's too late, and the actual engagement from the wind farm developers is very poor, although they would say otherwise. So I think that given where we are in terms of, you know, our need to generate clean energy, totally understand the need to consider more wind farms. I think we have to be more considerate about where they're going to be. I mean, I've you know, in my last term, I fought against one that was going to, and it went through anyway, that completely enclosed the town. So everywhere you look out the town, you see wind farms. And that was definitely not what the community wanted. So I think that my feeling is, and I wanted to put this to the community, is that engagement's not what it could be. There is, and because of that, real or otherwise, the perception is that there's a presumption that planning permission will be given for onshore wind, and that the public themselves have very little influence on that. So I think I wanted to speak to this petition. I wanted to give you, my constituents' feelings towards this, and as I say, my postbag's fairly full as a South of Scotland MSP. And I think there are this idea. I think we spoke last week on this that we perhaps one of the things, I'm flying a kite here, convener, we should be doing is giving areas where presumption will be granted. And that would be away from, commercial farming and et cetera, et cetera. So I think a better thought process through the planning application would be advantageous here for all, because as I read through the papers as well, and it's correct, that the length of time between application and building a wind farm is up to 13 years. And that can't be good for any of the parties involved here. So we have to find a better way to do this. And I think public engagement, as the petition asked for, is a positive way forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Mr. Whittle. Colleagues, I'm interested to know what suggestions you have. I mean, I think it's encouraging that the Minister's accepted two of the recommendations, but I think our continued concern may be a deliberation around the kind of vagueness potentially of the way in which they've responded in respect of the separate recommendation. Colleagues, does anybody wish to comment? Mr. Ewing?
I think first of all Mr. Whittle has made a number of reasonable points, and there's no doubt that many applications for wind farm developments can be extremely controversial, and I think all of us who have rural constituencies or regions are well aware of that, and there's very frequently objections. I think I make the point, it's quite hard sometimes to detect, and I'm not coming at this from any preconceived view, but it's difficult to detect to what extent the residents in a particular area within a reasonable radius of the proposed development are either for or against. In other words, there is a kind of more basic question about what is a community, and if there are, say, 300 people that live in an area within a few kilometres within the radius of a few kilometres of the proposed development, if 30 object out of 300, how significant is that? If 250 object, I think probably most people would think that's very significant. The point I'm making is it's sometimes quite difficult to detect, who is the community, and to what extent are the objectors representing the majority view or a minority view of the community? Because one or two people can make very vocal objections, as they're quite entitled to do and often do. So I think my recommendation, convener, is that we write to the Minister for Local Government and Empowerment and Planning to highlight the submission of the 26th of April, but seek clarification on the Scottish Government's definition of ensuring communities can have a meaningful say, that's in inverted commas, on planning applications, and with two particular requests. One, if they could respond to the question, what is a community? Is there any guidance to planning authorities about the extent to which the number of people within a particular area affected by development have to object before that is considered meaningful? And secondly, what does a meaningful say mean? And it does seem that this is not a particularly clear criteria to include in guidance, and clarity should be the key in guidance, I think, so that everybody knows where they stand. And it does somewhat, just finish with this point, that if communities can have a meaningful say, does that mean that other people who wish to make representations, individuals or businesses or charities or NGOs or local authorities, does that mean they shouldn't have a meaningful say? I wouldn't have thought so, but I don't know, because I don't really know what a meaningful say is.
I think that's an entirely reasonable observation, and I think it's a hostage to fortune in any event, because it's a term which allows everybody to be thoroughly dissatisfied in due course, because they'll take the view that their say turned out not to be meaningful. Mr. Stewart?
I concur with Fergus Ewing, convener, because I do think that the clarity is not here, and it has been identified by Mr. Whittle and Mr. Ewing that the confusion that can arise from some of this and the whole idea of individuals and organisations not getting the chance to put their say forward. And as we were identified, some pressure groups and some organisations can be very good at getting that message over, but it may not necessarily be the message for everybody within a community. But at the same time, the community requires to have an input. And some people are of the opinion that it's going to happen anyway. And, you know, local authorities make a decision and that's then overturned and the community don't want it. So there's a lot of effort that goes into some of this. And I do think that the meaningful say is problematic in the extreme as to what happens with that. So I would certainly concur with all of that.
Mr. Chowdhury?
Yes. How to appoint or nominate advocate for the members concerned community? Will this be a Scottish Government officials or spokesperson from the community? I think we need a clarification on this.
Okay, so I think it potentially not only is there a definition of what a meaningful say is, but are people responding, I suppose, in an official way on behalf of their community, or just more personally?
I'm just wondering who we asked that of.
Yes.
If a community council were to put in representation, then given that they are generally elected, although it's not always elections if there aren't enough people, but then should that be given greater weight than just a few individuals who are not on the community council? I mean, once one looks at the different options, it becomes more and more difficult to determine what community is.
Okay, well, we'll see. Work something around that. So we'll keep the petition open. Thank you very much, Mr. Whittle, and we'll proceed on that basis. Petition number 1900, access to prescribed medication for detainees in police custody, lodged by Kevin John Lawson, calling on the Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that all detainees in police custody can access their prescribed medication, including methadone, in line with existing relevant operational procedures and guidance, empowering local authorities to ensure local communities are given sufficient professional help to... I'm now reading the petition, sorry. We last considered this petition at our meeting on January the 18th, and of course it is a petition of some long standing, as colleagues will remember. And since that meeting we've received two written submissions from the Minister for Alcohol and Drugs Policy. And the first submission shares that NHS Grampian, who you will recall involved in these matters, has £1,052,919 per year allocated from the £10 million available to fund work on MAT standards. And it includes a letter from NHS Grampian stating that there has been a delay in obtaining the controlled drug licence application, that while it is difficult to give a definitive timescale, they are working to an application being made by the end of April 2023. So presumably, hopefully that's now occurred. A recent report has been brought to the attention of the committee in the Minister's second submission, and the Minister highlights that similar issues exist in NHS Lanarkshire as in NHS Grampian, and in response the Minister is committed to conducting a rapid review of each health board to ascertain the extent of these issues across Scotland, which I think is positive. The work will include writing to the Chief Executive of each Territorial Health Board and Police Scotland, details of which are included in the Clerk note. The Minister has stated that she will monitor the situation closely and provide updates to the committee as they become available. So I think that's actually quite a constructive response following the engagement that we've had with the Scottish Government. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Mr. Stewart?
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I do agree. I think that the rapid review is a way forward, and it has been identified that there are some areas within other health boards, and I think that it would be of benefit to note the recent commitment by the Minister of Alcohol and Drugs Policy to carry out that rapid review of each health board and keep the petition open pending completion of that exercise, because that will give us a much better overview of exactly where we are. You've identified Grampian and others that have a specific issue, and the Minister is aware of that, so let's just wait and see what comes back from the whole review and give us that exercise to see how things progress.
Okay. Mr Chowdhury.
Thanks, Convener. What systems are in place to receive suggestions, complaints, issues from the health workers in prison regarding this, their medication?
Sorry,
what systems are in place at the moment? I mean, do we have any update if there is, and how they cooperate with, or how you know, the health workers get involved? I mean, basically, what systems are in place just now?
Have we taken evidence on that? I can't recall. No, not particularly.
Do you think it would be helpful to know what systems in place just now?
I think that we previously established at an early stage that there were not formally recorded actions. And I think we got a commitment from the government at an earlier stage in the consideration of this petition, Mr Chowdhury, that they would introduce a formal recording of the prescribing of medicines, because it was, I think, an early consideration of this petition where we identified that although it was asserted that these things were happening, there was no way subsequently to demonstrate that that was the case. So I think the government, in a previous response, accepted a recommendation from the committee to change the procedures in order that a new process was put in place at that time. Our next petition is petition number 1906, to investigate the options for removing and reducing the impact of the central Glasgow section of the M8. This has been lodged by Peter Kelly on behalf of Replace the M8. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to commission an independent feasibility study to investigate scenarios for reducing the impact of the M8 between the M74 and Glasgow Cathedral, including specifically complete removal and repurposing of the land. And like the ghost of Christmas past, we are joined this morning by our former colleague Paul Sweeney, who previously spoke in petition in support of this petition when a member of the committee. Welcome back, Paul. Nice to see you. We've missed your independent analysis of our considerations, and I've been following with interest your public campaign in relation to these matters, about which we'll no doubt hear more in a moment. We previously considered this petition on the 23rd of November last, and since then we've received a response from the Scottish Government stating that Transport Scotland is happy to work with Glasgow City Council to ensure that all necessary stakeholders are included within any assessment. The submission states that no funding has been allocated by the Scottish Government towards an assessment, and that as discussions on the scope of any work have not taken place, it would not be appropriate to discuss funding at this time. And on that note, I'm happy to open up and ask Mr Sweeney if he has any comments or indeed any suggestions to the committee on how we might advance the interests of the petition.
Yeah, well, thank you, convener and colleagues. It's a pleasure to be back at the committee. I do miss coming along to participate. So it's great to be able to come back in this instance. As you're aware, the committee last looked at this petition in November last year, and since then there has been some positive developments. Most notably, the Glasgow City Council at its full council meeting recently agreed a motion to look at the future of the M8 and investigate options for mitigating its impact. And I think it's a question of, whilst removing the M8 in its entirety is quite a provocative statement, I'm sure some colleagues may think that, it's merely a sort of provocation to a wider discussion. So it's a large piece of land that actually incorporates the equivalent of the entirety of Inverness city centre. So it is a large amount of land in the centre of Glasgow, which can still be utilised as a road for its primary function, but I think the purpose of this petition is to investigate how we reduce the rather obnoxious design of the road in such a way that it can address its spatial and environmental impacts on the city centre. There's already been substantial amounts of work done on this, most notably a levelling up fund bid was submitted to cap the section of the motorway in front of the Mitchell Library between Bath Street and Sock Hill Street. Fortunately, that bid was unsuccessful, but it may well be revisited in a future round of the fund. Furthermore, there was a commission for district regeneration frameworks carried out. It was commissioned in 2016 and has produced a series of district regeneration frameworks for the entirety of the city centre, which highlighted particular interventions, particularly on the west flank of the M8 Inner Ring Road, which could be enabled to reduce the impact of the road, such as removing certain slip roads and capping and decking over sections of the motorway where it's in cutting, and aiming to restore areas like Anderston Cross, which is completely engulfed by a kind of spaghetti junction. Furthermore, there's a large cloverleaf junction at Townhead, which was over-engineered because it was designed for the east flank of the Inner Ring Road, which was never actually built. So it was built by Strathclyde Regional Council in the early 1990s, but actually was built to serve a motorway that was never built. So therefore, it's about a third over the size it should be and incorporates a huge amount of land which disconnects Royston, Springburn, Sighthill from the city centre. So there are options, whilst maintaining the fundamental purpose of the road, that could be significant to reduce it in the short, medium and longer term. So whilst it's good that there's an indicative proposal from the Scottish Government to work with Glasgow City Council, I think we really need a bit more on this. There's already been significant public money spent on studies and feasibility and specific interventions. Whilst we're seeing hundreds of millions of pounds spent on repairing the Woodside Viaducts, probably the biggest infrastructure spend in the city, which has been subject to no public consultation, it's a reactionary spend in reaction to the road physically crumbling apart. We really need a...
Which will be some reassurance if you were driving over it.
Indeed. It's been reduced to four lanes for some time now and a speed restriction placed on it. But nonetheless, it demonstrates that the road structurally is reaching the end of its natural lifespan without significant further investment. We're reaching a crux point here where the government really ought to be more thoroughly engaged. I think this Parliament has a role in overseeing that. And I think this committee, therefore, takes an important position in relation to this petition to sort of exercise that role. Therefore, I would urge the committee to consider inviting key stakeholders from both Transport Scotland, Scottish Government and Glasgow City Council to present their view on existing studies, such as the MVRDV District Regeneration Frameworks, which were commissioned at significant expense 5 years ago, the Levelling Up Fund bid for and how we progress these projects, which are kind of shovel-ready, to borrow a phrase from John Swinney.
OK, thank you very much. I must say I do find the petition quite an intriguing one. I should, I suppose, say I was at school with the son of the man who designed it all at the time. So I don't think that associates any personal blame with me in relation to it all. But I do remember it all being constructed with quite fascination in the early 1970s when I was at school. And it was quite a long journey prior to its construction. It was then quite a short journey, and then it became a very long journey again as traffic volumes became familiar with it. I've noted with interest your most recent online campaign in relation to the reconstruction of Charing Cross and the original buildings that I think were demolished over the bit up front of the Mitchell Library and along that are potentially open to being capped. Is that correct?
Yes. In the case of Charing Cross, the Grand Hotel and a number of other tenements and retail arcades were demolished to create the cutting for the M8. In that instance, there was an area that was decked over, but it's quite small. Actually, if you go to Café Gandolfi in the Merchant City and go through the rotating doors, that was actually the original doors from the Grand Hotel in Charing Cross that were salvaged. But the key point there is it demonstrates that there's an opportunity to further improve the environment here without damaging the fundamental utility of the road. The question now is, you know, half a century on from its first commissioning, we know that international examples show, for example, Boston's Big Dig, other examples around the world, we see what Paris is doing, we see what numerous other cities worldwide are doing. There is a big opportunity for us to enhance the city centre. Also, I would argue there's a potential to realise a positive capital net receipt for the public, because this is government-owned land. The land was all compulsory purchased by the Scottish Office at the time to construct the road. Therefore, by utilising the airspace over it, where possible, there is a potential for development to take place, which could return a positive net receipt to the public funds, which would not only enhance the city centre's amenity, but would also be financially sustainable as well. So it's not just this kind of quixotic idea about an urban plan and utopianism. It's about a serious and credible intervention based on international best practice.
I understand. And in fact, I was on a visit just a couple of weeks ago to the Jewish archive at Garnet Hill. And of course, when you're up at that height and actually trying to leave, you're aware that the kind of brutal truncation of a lot of the infrastructure round about there, which persists, had quite a detrimental effect on the kind of heart of that whole area of the city, which at one time was quite central to Glasgow and now is almost quite peripheral to it, with the centre having shifted much further in the other direction because the road really brutalised what was quite a significant part of the city at the time. However, while this is a fascinating conversation that we could enter into, Fergus Ewing.
Well, I'm just going to make a comment really just about the process, and having listened very carefully to what Paul Sweeney has said, and respecting his considerable interest in this matter and work that he's done on it. I mean, he makes a suggestion that we should take evidence, but I do wonder if he might feel that, given that that he also states that Glasgow Council is looking at options, whether the practical option for us as a committee may be to wait to see what the results of that work by the council is, in order to hear their view as the local authority, who, after all, are, I guess, well placed to voice the views of Glasgow alongside other representatives. Because if we first see what they recommend, then I think that gives us some clearer thesis on which to proceed. And perhaps if that is procedurally an appropriate way to proceed, I'm not making any judgments on the merits at all, then we could perhaps keep the petition open pro tem until that work is done. I don't know, Mr. Sweeney might be able to tell us how long that work is going to take. I mean, it could take 3 months or it could take 3 years, who knows. But I wondered if Mr. Sweeney felt that might be, you know, rather than shut the petition now, but keep it open to see, you know, what the local authority has got to say about the options, because I think you said they're looking at a variety of different options, and the issue, I'm quite sure, is absolutely not straightforward by any means.
Well, I think that's a fair comment. This was merely a motion passed by councillors, so the actual detailed sort of timeline or sequence of activity subsequent to that by officers hasn't been fully articulated yet. Furthermore, the point that the convener made about Transport Scotland saying whilst they're interested in working in principle, there's no resource to actually exercise that activity. I have concerns about how this will actually be expedited, and that's where I think the committee does have a role. Maybe it is slightly premature to invite everyone together to present a sort of pathway to how this would be carried out. Maybe we ought, well, maybe the committee ought to consider writing to Transport Scotland and Glasgow City Council to say, please indicate to us when you have undertaken a firm plan, so that we might have an opportunity to sort of talk about it or at least scrutinise it to some extent, so the Parliament has a role in overseeing that these stakeholders are working together, because I do detect a bit of animosity between Transport Scotland and Glasgow City Council with respect to this policy and how this evolves. I think Transport Scotland is very much programmed to, it's a trunk road, we just want to operate a trunk road, and we're not really interested about its aesthetic value, whereas obviously there's wider considerations with respect to Glasgow City Council and our parliamentary representatives.
I think, you know, Mr. Sweeney makes some very valid points, convener, about where this could go, and there is an issue about timescale, and there is an issue about the resource that may be required, and we acknowledge that. But I do think we need to get more clarity as to where and how. So a plan that Glasgow City Council have in mind and Transport Scotland would be very useful, just to ascertain exactly where we are, because I think there is real merit in some of this for the location that's been identified, and that as I say, should be examined and given more time for clarity to come back. And if that is the case, then that gives us a bigger option at the time. If there are other options on the table that we're going to receive from them, if they think about the timescales, the resource implications and what might happen in the location. Because as you identify, Mr. Sweeney, the life expectancy of the location will have to be managed in some shape, way or form. And it's as well to look at all options rather than just then putting something systematically through. You could achieve a lot more and make something of it where the location is because of that. And I think that is certainly something that I think we have an opportunity, convener, to develop as a committee and as this petition.
Well, on that basis, can I suggest, I mean, I take the point that Mr. Sweeney made, that in some ways the petition itself is there to provoke some sort of progress in a wider sense. And I do find some of the issues it raises quite intriguing, and from small seeds, big outcomes can follow if we show an interest and a commitment. So can I suggest that we do write to Glasgow City Council saying that we are very interested in the aims of this petition. We're minded at some stage potentially to facilitate a wider discussion, but that it would be useful at this first phase if they were able to give a little bit more detail or flesh out their own ideas as to what might follow, and to indicate that, you know, we're not necessarily requiring an immediate timescale to that. We recognise that this might require them to just do a little bit of thinking before they come back to the committee, but that on the back of that, that would allow us to have a better idea of how we might advance the aims of the petition. The committee agreed with that? That seemed fair? That's great. Thank you very much. That's how we'll do, and we'll keep the petition open on that basis. Thank you very much for joining us, Mr. Sweeney. That brings us to petition number 1953 to review education support staff roles. And this calls on the... lodged by Rosin Taylor-Young, and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review education support, ES, staff roles in order to consider urgently raising wages for education support staff across primary and secondary sectors to 26k per annum, to increase the hours of the working day for ES staff from 27.5 to 35 hours, and to allowing ESS to work on personal learning plans with teachers taking part in multilingual meetings. Requiring ESS to register with Social Services, Scottish Social Services Council, and paying ES staff monthly. And we previously considered this petition at our meeting on the 9th of November last. COSLA's submission states that there are no national rates for non-teaching staff, and pay levels are determined through job evaluation. The submission notes that a separate salary increase for one group would have a wider impact in other roles and raise affordability concerns. Similarly, the submission explains that pupil support assistants work varying hours based on pupil needs, and changing this would have financial implications for various roles within councils. And it notes that involvement in personal learning plans and multi-agency meetings varies locally and is determined by school and teacher discretion. And lastly, COSLA notes that the issue of pay periods and its impact on universal credit falls under the responsibility of UK benefits. Now, the committee's also received a response from the then Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, which indicates that the Bute House Agreement Exploration Group will share its recommendations on a qualification and registration programme for additional support needs assistance by the autumn of this year. And we've received a written submission from the petitioner, which has been shared with the committee this morning, a late submission, and I'm aware of a technical issue, unfortunately, which caused the submission to be received late through no fault of the petitioner. So thank you to her, particularly, for working with the clerks to get this submission to us in time for us to consider it this morning. And the petitioner's submission raises a number of points in response to the submissions we've received, to which I've just alluded. She asks that the Bute House Agreement Exploration Group consider recommending national rather than local agreements for the registration and accreditation of education support staff in schools. The petitioner highlights the school support staff, the Way Forward, that's the name of the document, agreement produced by the National Education Union in England, which has considered similar issues, in fact, to those of the Exploration Group. The petitioner highlights, in response to COSLA's submission, that the single status agreement is almost 2.5 decades old, and that pay disparity exists between areas such as Edinburgh and Glasgow. The Harper Trust versus Brazel case from 2022 is highlighted and put into the context of this petition, with cautionary points about the potential implications of backdated unfair pay claims. The petitioner concludes by suggesting a number of options for the committee to pursue, and I wonder on that basis if members have any comments or suggestions. Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I do think we should continue to keep the petition open at this stage. The petitioner in the submission they've given does make some very valid points about where we are in this whole process. So I would suggest that we write to the Scottish Government seeking an update on the Bute House Agreement exploratory group recommendations when they're available in autumn of this year. Because I think by doing that, the petitioner also talks about what's caused there's been involvement in all of that too. And I think that it would be good to get some clarity with reference to that. So I would propose that convene at this stage.
Are we content to pursue? So thank you very much again to Roisin for her additional work and allowing us to consider matters this morning. And we will move forward on that basis. Is there anything else we can think to do, or are we content with that? It is. Okay, fine. Thank you very much. That brings us then to petition number 1958. Extend aftercare for previously looked after young people and remove the continuing care age gap. This petition was lodged by Jasmine Kasaya Pilling. And I'm not sure. Yes, my eyesight is sometimes a little bit dodgy, but I thought I spotted her joining us this morning. So welcome to you in the gallery on behalf of Who Cares Scotland. And the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to extend aftercare provision in Scotland to previously looked after young people who left care before their 16th birthday on the basis of individual need. Extend continuing care throughout care experienced people's lives on the basis of individual need, and to ensure care experienced people are able to enjoy lifelong rights and achieve equality with non-care experienced people. And this includes ensuring that the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child and the findings of the Promise are fully implemented in Scotland. And you'll recall, colleagues, we previously discussed this at our meeting on the 19th of April, where we heard evidence from the petitioner, Jasmine, and representatives from Who Cares Scotland, CELSIS, the Centre for Excellence for Children's Care and Protection, the Children and Young People's Commissioner Scotland, and the Promise Scotland at the time. Members will also recall that ahead of our last consideration, there was an informal discussion with care experienced individuals and their advocates. And a note of that discussion has now been published on the petition's website page. And during those evidence sessions, we heard about the importance of ensuring individuals are aware of their rights, and that seemed to be a major concern, and particularly the consequences of being removed from supervision orders before their 16th birthday. We also heard about the inconsistent application of existing support, both within local authorities and across the country, and the need to ensure the provisions of the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014 are fully implemented. And I think that, we've all had time to reflect on the evidence that we heard, and I'm pretty certain there's considerable additional work for us to consider now doing, having done so. I wonder if there are any suggestions from the committee as to what we might do. I mean, I think at some stage down the line here, we would want to hear from the Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promise. But I wonder if there's anything we might think to do in advance of that. Mr. Stewart?
I agree with you. I think, this petition has opened up a much bigger options, and it is about rights, and it is about the inconsistencies that we have now found. So I would concur with you, Convener, that the Minister should come and give us some evidence, and it might be useful for us to seek from the Scottish Government what action it's addressing in the capacities of workforce issues to ensure care experienced people can access support when they need to do that. And as you've already said, I think plans to bring forward legislation on the Promise are also vitally important in this whole process. So I think the Minister coming and getting some more clarity on both of those areas, I would suggest is another start for us to take this whole process, because I do believe that we will learn more from the Scottish Government side of things when we do have the Minister actually here giving evidence on behalf of this petition.
And now, obviously, there are a number of questions we could put to the Minister in advance, or we can put to the Minister in evidence. I mean, is there a preference in the committee? I mean, do we ask for some more detailed information in advance of...
I think we could also write, as you rightly identified, we could write to the Minister asking what is to be considered by the Scottish Government and local authorities to ensure that the end of the practice of removing the compulsory supervision orders and seek information on the Scottish Government will consider attending the Children Scotland Act 1995 to ensure that the duty to provide consultations care applies to care experienced people who need, even if that has ceased to be looked after the 16th birthday. So I think all of that that we had a very good discussion from the when we took evidence previously, that I think could also be ascertained prior to the Minister arriving to the committee.
Or I suppose we could write saying those will be the areas that the committee will be very particularly interested in focusing on. So I think if we pull together, I think, the information and the concerns that the committee had and flag up to the Minister that those will be areas that we are seeking to actually address when we take evidence from the Minister directly. So we're content to proceed on that basis. So we're keeping the petition open. We're inviting the Minister to join us at a future meeting, post the summer recess, obviously, now, at which we will take more detailed evidence on behalf of this petition and see what further progress we can make. OK, thank you all very much. Petition number 1960, to formally recognise private hire cars and taxis as modes of public transport. Now, this is a petition lodged by Edward Grice, and he is also protagonist of petition number 1961, which we'll consider in a moment, and it is lodged on behalf of the Scottish Private Hire Association, calling on the Scottish Government to formally recognise private hire cars and taxis as modes of public transport and to enshrine such recognition in law. We previously considered this petition at our meeting on the 7th of December, where we agreed to write to the Scottish Government, the Society of Chief Officers of Transportation Scotland, the Confederation of Passenger Transport and Heads of Planning Scotland. And we've since received responses from the Confederation of Passenger Transport and the Scottish Government. And as noted in papers for today's meeting, Heads of Planning Scotland declined to provide a formal response, indicating that they would defer to the views of the Society of Chief Officers of Transportation on this matter. And unfortunately, a response from that organisation, our society, has not been forthcoming. So we're none the wiser. The Scottish Government has responded with information on the Short Life Working Group, which was tasked with reviewing and updating the taxi and private hire car licensing best practice for licensing authorities document. And we understand that the petitioner was a member of this working group whose work has now concluded. CPT's response states that it only represents the bus and coach sector. There is no formal role for taxi and private hire in its organisational structure, which really goes to the heart of the issue. And it goes on to say that while it's sympathetic to the petitioner's concern that the sector is not being fully consulted with on transport issues, it does not agree that classifying taxi and private hire vehicles as modes of public transport would help achieve the Scottish Government's stated desire to reduce car kilometres. Who are the Confederation of Public Passenger Transport, I'm inclined to ask? The petitioner has responded to dispute CPT's interpretation of the term private vehicle and has drawn our attention to the taxi trade's classification as public hire, as well as licensing provisions that can enable taxi and private hire cars to offer taxi bus services. I'm genuinely, in the first instance, unsure now who or what funds the Confederation of Passenger Transport. Is this an agency of the government? Because coming back to... I just feel their response and coming back with what I would say is a politically provocative judgment about why the petitioner's aims can't be accommodated because they contradict something for which they don't have a responsibility, is a bit striking. Any suggestions?
I think there's no doubt there continues to be a loophole in this whole process for that sector and private hire and taxis. So I think we once again continue to ask for more clarity, and we write to the Traffic Commissioner for Scotland to seek their views on the action called for in the petition and how many special restriction licences are currently registered within Scotland, because, as I say, I do think that they have a very valid point here in asserting what they are. And yes, the Short Life Working Group may have concluded, but it hasn't come back with anything specifically for the sector. So the sector are still being left in some kind of limbo.
Thanks, Greg. I wonder also if we could ask Spice or someone to investigate CPT, just to find out. I'd like to know who funds them, because there may be a conflict of interest there which hasn't been made obvious to us in the submission that they've left us with. Are we content on that basis with that petition? We are. Moving on to petition 1961. To make it a specific offence to assault, threaten or abuse a private hire or taxi driver while at work. As I mentioned a moment ago, also in the name of Edward Grice, on behalf of the Scottish Private Hire Association. And this petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to expand the Protection of Workers, Retail and Age-Restricted Goods and Services Scotland Act 2021 to include private hire and taxi drivers by creating a specific criminal offence of assaulting, threatening or abusing private hire or taxi drivers while they are engaged in private hire or taxi work, and considering such offences as aggravated when the offence is committed whilst the driver is enforcing a licensing or operational condition. Now, we again considered this petition along with the previous one on the 7th of December, when we agreed to seek further information from Police Scotland, the Scottish Taxi Federation, and also from the trade union Unite. And since then, we've received a response from Unite in support of legislating to protect private hire and taxi drivers, but recommending that the scope of any such legislation be extended to include all transport workers. The petitioner has indicated they would be agreeable to this suggestion. Police Scotland has provided data on the number of breach of the peace and threatening or abusive behaviour offences recorded over the past 10 years, but were unable to provide occupational breakdown. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Mr Stewart?
I do think, convener, that we've taken this petition to a level that I think is probably as far as we probably can take it in some respects. And there is some common law and there is some statutory offences in other areas that fall into this. So I would be at this stage proposing that we close the petition under 15.7 of standing orders on the basis that the type of behaviour referenced in the petition may already be prosecuted under common law and existing statutory offences.
Any other thoughts?
Could there be a potential for a new bill similar to Daniel Johnson that would cover transport workers, considering retail workers and taxis, private workers?
Well, I think the route would be, were there a route to pursue, to amend the Act, the 21 Act, to include private hire and taxi drivers, which is the suggestion Unite have now suggested they would support. Sorry? It would require a bill to amend it. It's not just a case of waving a wand and us all sort of saying aye. It requires there's a bit more of a process to it. I'm inclined to give it one last hurrah, in the sense that I think Unite have come in support of the petitioner, who has said that he would be agreeable to the suggestion they've made. I think I can anticipate the Scottish Government's response, but nonetheless, I think given that it's had that additional level of support, and I think we can flag up that is the case in any submission, to say that, you know, we are minded to see specifically again whether the government might be prepared to contemplate that, if even only in the longer term. Are you content with that, Mr. Stewart? That's fine. Thank you very much. That takes us to item three, which is a consideration of new petitions. And of course, as I usually and customarily do, just for those who might be joining us for the first time this morning, to see the progress of a petition, to make clear that ahead of our consideration of it, we do invite the Scottish Government to comment, and also the Parliament's independent research body, SPICE, to have a look at it as well. And that just helps inform the committee so that we can proceed to discuss matters in a meaningful way. And the first of those petitions is petition number 2012, which is to remove the need for follicle-stimulating hormone, FSH, blood tests before prescribing hormone replacement therapy, HRT. And it's been lodged by Angela Hamilton and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to remove the need for follicle-stimulating hormone blood tests in women aged 40 to 45 who are experiencing menopause symptoms before hormone replacement therapy can be prescribed to relieve their symptoms and replenish hormone levels. Now, Angela tells us that she is aware of many women aged 40 to 45 who have all the symptoms of perimenopause, but because their blood tests do not confirm this, they are dismissed by doctors and left to endure debilitating symptoms which affect all aspects of their lives. In responding to the petition, the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health highlights NICE guidance that HRT can be offered without the need for a blood test when other symptoms are present, but a blood test may be required to rule out other illnesses. Now, the Minister also mentions that NHS Education for Scotland has been commissioned to create a bespoke training package focused on menopause, including perimenopause and menstrual health, and that there is now a specialist menopause service in every mainland NHS health board, with a buddy system in place for island health boards. The petitioner, Angela, has also provided a submission which shares the experiences of women with perimenopause symptoms seeking help from their GPs and who have been left feeling dismissed and let down. And colleagues will remember this is very often a common theme in petitions. The petitioner also raises concerns about NICE guidelines not being consistently followed by local health boards, with a specific concern about the prescription of antidepressants for women with menopause symptoms. So, a different area of women's healthcare. Unfortunately, some similarities in terms of the patient experience, and an appeal to this committee to see what more we might be able to do about it. And I think that we would want to keep it open in the first instance and write, I might suggest that we write to the Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynaecologists to seek their view on the action called in the petition. Are there any other suggestions? Is that Mr. Stewart?
As you identify, convener, this is a major problem, or it would appear to be a major problem. And women are being let down. I think my mailbag over the last 7 years and even prior to that has had many of this, and I think this is something that's further moving up the agenda within women's health. So I think what you're suggesting, I would also suggest that we write to the NHS Education to Scotland to seek information on the development of that bespoke training that has been discussed, and the framework focused on menopause and how the training is being rolled out to GPs and primary healthcare providers, because that's the biggest problem that we seem to have at the moment, that there is not a consistency. And there seems to be that they are dismissed and have to endure and suffer for a number of years. So I think by doing both of those, that will give us an opportunity to see where we are.
Yeah, I think I agree with Mr. Alexander. I mean, why the training programme is not mandated, I think that should be, because that's going to affect half of our population. And I think the training programme should be mandated.
Okay, thank you. Are we content to proceed with the suggestions as have been made by colleagues? We are. The second of the three new petitions we're considering this morning, petition number 2014, revert to the appeal system used in 2022 for SQA exams. This has been lodged by Elliot Hepburn on behalf of Moffat Academy students, calling on the Scottish Government to implement a revised SQA appeals process which takes into account evidence of the pupil's academic performance throughout the year, particularly prelim results. The SPICE briefing states that the Scottish Government intends to replace the SQA, and it is expected that a bill will be introduced later this year for the purpose. The briefing outlines the appeal system used in 2022 and notes that the SQA described the 22 appeals process as an emergency response due to the COVID-19 disruption. The SQA conducted a review of the certification appeals processes, including a consultation with learners, teachers, parents and others, and the review found several issues, including increased workload for teachers and perceptions of unfairness in the process, which I think all MSPs probably received representations in relation to. Views on the approach for the 23 appeals were mixed. The SQA appeals process for 2023 will involve a marking review by a senior marker focusing on the correctness and consistency of the initial marking, and it no longer considers alternative assessment evidence. The process is free and individuals can apply directly to the SQA. The Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills has responded to the petition, stating that the SQA is responsible for its operational decisions, including its approach to the appeals process for 2023. The Cabinet Secretary's response highlights the Exam Exceptional Circumstances Consideration Service, which supports pupils who are unable to attend their exams due to reasons out with their control, or whose performance may have been affected by personal circumstances. I mean, I'm struck. So the appeals process now is simply that a senior marker focuses on the correctness and consistency of the initial marking and no longer considers alternative assessment evidence, which I have to say I previously thought was very often the principal thing that many schools submitted on behalf of pupils, was here is evidence to suggest that the individual had done better than this had. This process is example. However, notwithstanding that, that's what's happening in 2023, and I imagine colleagues elsewhere intimately concerned with these issues will have debated them thoroughly. We're in a situation where the Scottish Government, I think, are indicating that a bill is going to be forthcoming which is going to alter the situation. So I'm not sure there's terribly much more we can do at this stage. Mr. Ewing?
Well, it's relatively early. It's in the life of the petition, I suppose. It's not. The point that you make there, Convener, that it seems, on grounds of equity, that in some cases, looking at other evidence such as continuous assessment and the progress made by a pupil over the course of the period in respect of which the examinations relate, would be helpful. And, you know, I think we're all conscious that for every child, for every pupil, the results of their qualifications can determine the future. A lot's at stake, and this is something of huge moment to children and their families. And therefore, I did notice that the Cabinet Secretary for Education stated alternative evidence will not be needed for the appeals service this year. Well, that's a statement, it's an assertion, but I wonder if we might invite her just to flesh that out and state, you know, with a bit more detail in what, why that view should now be the case where previously it wasn't. Are there not circumstances, particularly where there's an element of difficulty, problems, trouble in the life of the child, such as an interruption to education through ill health or other issues of that ilk, which may well merit consideration of alternative evidence. Now, maybe the system does provide for that separately. I don't know. I'm not an expert in it at all. But I'm sure we've all had cases over the years where the outcome of an examination has been very much out of line with the prediction. And that, in turn, has led to lots of soul-searching and problems in individual cases. So because of the importance of this to children in general, I wouldn't want just to close the petition now, but rather, I hope I'm putting this clearly, but rather seek from the Cabinet Secretary a much greater explication of why it is that alternative evidence would not appear to be relevant this year, when in principle, prima facie, there are surely many circumstances where the consideration of alternative evidence is not only appropriate but essential.
Yes, I'm content that we should do that. I wonder whether we might also ask the SQA the very same question. And I think we would be interested to know the basis on which they've concluded that simply the academic review of the correctness of the marking is sufficient, because the exam diet is now coming to a conclusion and results will be forthcoming in the next few months, and this therefore will become a very live issue for a considerable number of people. And I think it would be interesting for us to take the petition forward, at least to that extent, to have a greater clarity as to why that would be the case. And I think maybe we might ask what practical implication they believe that will have in relation to the outcome of appeals this year in comparison with previous. Are we content to do that? Mr. Chowdhury?
The question is, will they be publishing the final report? Do they have any...
Which report is this, Mr. Chowdhury? Sorry.
Independent reviews.
Right, and we'll ask that of the Scottish Government?
That's correct, yeah.
Right. Well, if they maybe just discern what that might lead to, and we'll see how we can check that forward.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. And the final new petition we're considering today is petition number 2015 to extend the right to vote in Scottish local government and Scottish Parliament elections to all prisoners. And this has been lodged by Irene Krasmanovic. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to extend the right to vote in Scottish local government and Scottish Parliament elections to all prisoners held in Scottish prisons. On the 4th of May this year, ministers laid a copy of the report on the review of the operation of Section 5 of the Scottish Elections Franchise and Representation Act 2020. The report concludes by stating that the Scottish Government's position remains that it is neither appropriate nor necessary to ensure compliance with the European Convention on Human Rights to enfranchise all prisoners, but that the correct balance is found in extending voting rights to those prisoners serving shorter sentences. It states clearly that the Scottish Government does not plan to revisit the 12-month threshold for prisoner voting. That's a fairly expressed direction. Do colleagues have any suggestions on how we might proceed with the petition? Mr. Ewing?
Well, the Scottish Government have replied very clearly and at considerable length, and this issue has been looked at considerably before. It seems to me that there's very little prospect of any change. And I would just comment that, you know, there's some people who take the view, certainly from work I've done over the years, that those people who are subject to a long-term imprisonment by virtue of having committed crimes for which they're required to be incarcerated and have their liberty withdrawn, means that they should not enjoy the benefits of freedom, which include the right to vote. And I just make that for the record, because it has been a view expressed to me by many over the years, very strongly indeed.
I believe has also been very much at the heart of the debate that's been held in Parliament. So I think given the express direction that we've received, the Scottish Government's got no plan to revisit the 12-month threshold, that under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders, that we move to close the petition on the basis that the Scottish Government's position remains that it's neither appropriate nor necessary to ensure compliance with the European Convention on Human Rights to enfranchise all prisoners, but that the correct balance is found in extending voting rights to those prisoners serving shorter sentences. Are we content to do that? We are. Thank you all very much. The next meeting of the Public Petitions Committee will be on Wednesday the 14th of June 2023, when we'll be taking evidence from, among others, Scotland's Lord Advocate. But that concludes the public section of this morning's meeting, and we now move into private session. Thank you very much.